such a long string of numbers that I think it's enough to label every atom in the universe or something. I mean, it's one of those very big numbers, at least in computer terms. Probably physicists might disagree. IP is Internet Protocol. IP numbers, they're used to, as addresses. So these are used to let you get data to a particular place, to a particular machine. And that's the function the IP address serves. IP addresses, in particular, I'll do examples with IPv4. So this is the kind of the current internet. It's called version 4. I don't think versions 1 to 3 were ever really deployed. It's been version 4 since the 70s. So the sort of examples you might see, this kind of thing would be 128.243.35.9. So at one point that was the IP address of one of my computers here. I don't think it is currently. This is an IP address in what's called dotted quad notation. So you've got dots and you've got 4 bytes. Each of these numbers here will be less than or equal to 255, because 255 is the biggest decimal number you can represent in a single byte. You have this dotted quad notation, and that will get turned into, in an IP packet, into just this series of bits. Okay, so I'm not going to try and do the binary all in my head, but it's going to be something, I think that, if I remember rightly, will be kind of 128, 243, similarly, all the way through to 9, which would be 1001. Okay, so that's just going to be this sequence of bits is your IP address, your IPv4 address. By putting that sequence of bits in the right place at the start of your packet, it's going to get treated as a destination address by all the routers on the path. You imagine the internet as a sequence of routers that are all sort of connected in some means like this. Then if your packet comes in here and it's trying to get to some guy out here, it's going to get to this router here, and that router has to make a decision which way to send it. And it's going to do that using longest prefix match on the destination address. Look it up in the table and decide, should it send it out of interface A or interface B? So that router is going to receive your data. They're going to pull off whatever the stuff on the front of it, the Ethernet headers and so on, might be. They're going to get an IP packet, which is going to have an IP header and some data following it. And in the header, they're going to go and look in a particular location in the header, see this sequence of bits. Then they're going to look that sequence of bits up in the table, the entry that matches the best match they can find, the so-called longest prefix match, so the longest sequence from the start all the way back that just matches exactly on those bits, will point to a particular entry in that table, and that entry in that table will say which network interface it should transmit it out of usually. So who decides what these numbers are? So these numbers get assigned hierarchically. So there's a body called IANA, the Internet Assigned Numbers Authority, I think, if I get that right. But basically this is a body which has administrative control over all of these numbers. It will hand them out to the regional authorities. So there might be one for Europe, there might be one for Asia Pacific, there might be one for North America. And then those bodies will hand them out to perhaps national authorities. So I might hand it out to the UK, you might hand it out to the United States, and so on. And so this prefix here, which always refers to the first 16 bits, has been handed out to the University of Nottingham. So University of Nottingham computers will typically be, I don't know if we have other prefixes, but certainly many of them will be within that prefix. So that means that any packet on the internet that has that prefix at the beginning of an address in the destination address field will eventually wend its way towards our computers here in Nottingham.
There are a lot more computers in the world than that can deal with, surely.
There are nowadays, yeah. Back in the day there weren't so many, but yeah, now there are. And that's one of the reasons that IPv6 was perceived as having a great benefit, just the amount of addresses in it. So IPv6, instead of being 32 bits, so 4 bytes, is 128 bits. So it's just much bigger addresses. Like 2 to the 128 is a very large number, at least in computer terms. And one of the reasons IPv6 took a long time to kind of take off was that essentially there's quite a lot of cost implications, because you have to upgrade the software and in some cases probably the hardware as a result of lots of the routers that live inside these networks. You had to get software installed on, you've got to get your home routers able to support this stuff. You've got to get all the software stacks, networking protocol stacks on your devices to support this stuff. So Windows had to be updated to support IPv6, for example. And it has done for some time now, but that was a process that it had to go through. That was a new piece of software implementation that you had to get right, had to get tested, all that kind of stuff. There's a bunch of services that need to be upgraded to support IPv6. So for example, the name translation service. DNS is the protocol that lets you translate the google.com name into the IP address. When that was designed and developed, IPv4 was the only IP going. And so that whole DNS infrastructure had to be upgraded and updated to support this new protocol. So there's quite a lot of sort of knock-on effects of updating this, and it's not as simple as just saying, well, we'll have more bits for the address. there's lots of other interdependent services that have to also support that. And I think the amount of complexity that there was there perhaps was surprising how expensive it was to go through that process. Because it took longer to get IPv6 deployed than expected, and indeed that's still kind of going on, although it is starting to see, I think, significant deployment now. People had to come up with other ways of dealing with that when you've got too many machines and not enough addresses. And so that's where you get NAT happening. NAT is network address translation. We don't have enough addresses to represent every machine. So what we can do is we can kind of fake things out.